singer-songwriter Suzanne Vega emerged from the New York folk scene in the mid-1980s. Using a simple acoustic style, she stormed the charts with hits like Luca and Marlena on the Wall. Vega's faith motivates her to portray through her music the difficult issues in life. For Suzanne, spirituality helps her to make sense of the world, a world over which she feels she has no control.
I've often felt that I knew things that I didn't know how I knew them. That I knew things that didn't make sense to my mind, but that made sense in other ways, and that they would eventually come to pass, and that kind of thing. And so the idea that there's an order to the world and an order to nature has always been very important to me, even before I was a practicing Buddhist. My first memories are of growing up in East Harlem, but with gangs of kids all over the street all the time. We were raised without any formal religion until I was about 16. Up until that point, we didn't have any, really. I would go to church with my grandmother when I would visit her in Puerto Rico, because she taught me how to pray, and she would tell me that you get down on your knees before you go to bed and you fold your hands and sort of bless everybody that you can think of, basically everyone in your family, and which I would do. And then I would sort of put in my petition for what I would hope would happen the next day. And my most vivid memory is, of course, being wanting to go to the beach and saying, "Dear God, please make it a nice day tomorrow." And of course it rained, and I complained to my grandmother, and she said, "Well, you don't tell God anything that you're supposed to ask." And that to me seemed like a waste of time. Why should you ask if it's not going to happen, you know? And so that sort of, I remember feeling daunted by that. Because until then, everything seemed to work out pretty nicely.
Vega grew up in Spanish Harlem, a tough Puerto Rican neighborhood in New York. From an early age, her paler skin attracted attention. She was often bullied and seen as different to her brothers and sisters.
Being in Spanish Harlem just made me feel estranged. I felt like an odd one out. But I did have the sense of being different, and I think it was because I could read, and because I tended to be bookish and introspective. So, you know, most of the kids would be out sort of fighting or playing street games and that kind of thing, and I tended to be in my own world. These days, when you go up and look at it, there's a lot of burned out buildings and empty lots. Sometimes you'll see big murals where people have done drawings and paintings, sometimes commemorating people who have died. New York is a really good city for feeling isolated, and I find that's where I feel most comfortable, is when I'm in a crowd with no one looking at me, you know, where I'm sort of one of a group and I can sort of sense what people are feeling or look at other people and wonder what they're going through. That's the point of view that a lot of songs happen in. A song like Tom's Diner is basically, you're by yourself, you're in a diner, you're surrounded by people, you're looking at them, you're not exactly involved with them, but you're thinking of them and connected in some way, in some private way. And that's a state of mind you find yourself in all the time if you're in New York. If you ride the subways and take the buses and walk down the street and eat in the diners. And it's kind of a very ordinary feeling. This song is called Tom's Diner, and it's about Tom's restaurant in New York City on 112th Street and Broadway, if you're ever there. I am sitting in the morning at the diner on the corner. I am waiting at the counter for the man to pour the coffee, and he fills it only halfway, and before I even argue, he is looking out the window at somebody coming in.
It is always nice to see you, says the man behind the counter to the woman who has come in. She is shaking her umbrella, and I look the other way as they are kissing their hellos, and I'm pretending not to see them, and instead I pour the milk.
Things all changed when Vega's family moved to the Upper West Side in Manhattan. Having been brought up with no strong sense of formal religion, she was given a new sense of focus when the whole family embraced Buddhism in the mid-1970s. This helped her to answer some of the questions she was asking in her adolescence.
This was a more outgoing form of Buddhism called Nichiren Shoshu. And you chant for the things that you want. And I remember being very interested at that point, because at the age of 16, I was very interested in religion and hungry for some kind of religious thought and some way of, although I didn't know it, I was looking for a way to express faith or a way to pray, for example. How do you ask? My mother and father, and then all of my brothers and sisters and I, we would do prayers every morning and evening. So that consisted of reciting parts of the Lotus Sutra out loud. It takes 25 minutes in the morning and 15 at night, and then we would chant extra. If you had other, you know, a lot of things you wanted to chant about, you could chant as much as an hour or 2 hours. And it was very active, you make a sound with your body and comes out through your mouth, and you have the beads and you rub them together. So it's really making quite a racket if you... so it was a completely different sort of physical experience.
Struggling with her weight and appearance and unhappy at dance school, the teenage Vega began to express her creativity through her music. One of Suzanne's earliest songs, Undertow, was originally called Hunger, and describes a desire to be spiritually and physically in control.
I believe right now if I could, I would swallow you whole. I would leave only bones and teeth. We could see what was underneath, and you would be free then.
Physically and mentally, emotionally and spiritually, that was kind of what I was after. To make myself as sleek as possible and hopefully that I would feel more powerful, because I did not feel very powerful at that time. So all of those ideas are in that song, the idea of kind of stripping yourself away to be as sleek as possible. And what I found, instead of being sort of stripped down and the wish to be stripped down like a bullet or like a diamond, was that instead I felt myself getting weaker and weaker.
I am friend to the undertow. I take you in, I don't let go, and now I have you.
But I mean, I suppose that's a sort of a spiritual struggle that a lot of women, I think, go through. You want to be strong, you want to be independent, so you try and strip things down and control your hungers and your appetites.
I wanted to learn all the secrets from the edge of a knife, from the point of a needle, from a diamond, from a bullet in flight. I would be free then.
A turning point in Suzanne's life came when she discovered that she wasn't Puerto Rican, because her natural father had left home when she was a baby. Suddenly, a childhood alienation made sense, and she felt compelled to find out more about her heritage and roots. Suzanne's spiritual journey took her to Japan.
Well, we're talking about a pilgrimage, and it was the first time I'd been to Japan, I went at that time because I was trying to make sense of a lot of different things that were happening in my life. There was I was having a tremendous success at that point that was building. So I wanted to give thanks. And there were things that were still unresolved in my life. Mostly that I had not met my natural father, my biological father, and I wasn't sure where he was in the world, and it was something that I felt that I wanted to resolve. I wanted to find him. So I went, and those were the things that I had chanted for at that time, were to find my father and for the success of my record of Solitude Standing. As well as just I wanted to go, just because everyone went. Everyone who had gone before that had said it was a real turning point in their lives. And I found that it was a turning point for me as well.
Solitude stands by the window. She turns her head as I walk in the room. I can see by her eyes she's been waiting. Standing in the slant of a late afternoon. And she turns to me with her hand extended. Palm is split with a flower with a flame.
I guess in some ways I like to think of religion as being a very utilitarian thing. You know, how do you use it in your life? How do you use it? Can you use it for very mundane things, which is one of the things that I had really liked about the form of Buddhism that I was practicing. If you were having a problem with your mother, or if you needed something, a job or an apartment, you could feel free to chant about that, and somehow it would get resolved in your life. With Buddhism, there was the sense of making a cause for your life, and that by changing the causes in your life, you change the effects. And that was part of what you were doing by chanting, was by making new causes in your life. I think on the last day of that year was the day I spoke to my father for the first time. I decided to hire a detective and to find my father, and they found him in about 2 weeks, and he was easy to find. And I waited till Christmas time, and I wrote him a note at Christmas, and then he called me the day before New Year's Eve. New Year's Eve day is when we spoke. So in a sense, it was very neat. You know, the ending of it was very, I'd had these goals, and I chanted for them, and I achieved them, you know, within that space of time. And it was kind of great, you know.
Between 1986 and 87, Vega's live show sold out around the world. Her album, Solitude Standing, went gold, and she was winning awards and Grammy nominations.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please give a warm welcome to A&M recording artist Suzanne Vega.
Yet, at the most public, she was about to discover something so startling that only her faith could help her understand it.
My most spiritual moments, I guess, have had to do with the idea that I'm a part of something that is much larger than myself, something that makes a pattern and has an order to it that I'm a part of. I don't know how else to put it, really. Some of it has to do with having met my father and learning things about my family and realizing that I had imitated my grandmother's way of life without knowing it. You know, here I thought I'd be clever and become a musician and go on tour and live this life that I felt was very unique and very original. And it certainly was compared to my other brothers and sisters. And when I spoke to my father, he had told me that 2 years previously he had found his own family because he had been adopted as a child, so he didn't know his own background. And he had found out that his mother and his father were both musicians on the road. That's how they had met. My grandfather was a trumpet player and my grandmother was a drummer. And they had lived their life touring as musicians in the 30s and met and got married, had four children, divorced. Gave my father up for adoption and put the other three children in an institution, and then my grandmother continued on with her career. I mean, I had the very peculiar sense of being part of something much way beyond my own, what my own mind could comprehend. And so that would be one moment, I would say, where I found myself to be part of a pattern that was much larger than myself.
The desire to understand these much larger patterns is something that Vega also tries to confront in her music.
It's my job as a songwriter to write about those corners of life that most people don't get to or don't like. You know, I've written about mental illness, attempted suicide, post-traumatic stress syndrome. I mean, there are a lot of things that I've written about. I never say to myself, well, I'm going to pick a topic and write about it. It's usually something that has either grown out of my own life or something close to my own life. So the fact that it's something that nobody wants to hear about has never stopped me from writing about it. To me, it's a challenge.
The biggest impact Vega has made in her career to date touched the lives of millions of people all over the world.
I was living in a building actually not far from here in my early 20s, and there was a boy named Luca who lived in my building. He lived upstairs from me. I would get his mail from time to time. And in fact, if I had known how successful the song was going to be, I wouldn't have used his real name, which has always made me feel slightly guilty. Even though he himself was not an abused child, he was, as far as I could see, just kind of ordinary, slightly wise guy, New York kid. He had a sort of beautiful, sensitive face. He was very thin. Which is probably what attracted me to Tim, because he had this sort of otherworldly quality about him, but at the same time, he was a kind of a wise guy.
My name is Luca. I live on the second floor. I live upstairs from you. Yes, I think you've seen me before.
Well, I was really shocked in a way. First of all, to see how many people knew what the song was about, because I didn't say what the song was about. The song is about child abuse, and there's nowhere in the song does it say I'm being abused, or even this child is being abused. The word abuse doesn't show up. I mean, there's no violence in the song. So the idea that people would, first of all, care what it was about was very shocking to me. And that they would want to talk about it was shocking to me. I didn't feel that I had written a hit in a sense that I felt that the public and the media made it into a hit and responded to it. And that was a shock to me. I mean, and I got a lot of letters from men who had been abused as children, from women who had been abused and were still being abused, and from children, although not a lot of children, some were teenagers who were in unfortunate situations or who had been abused as kids and wanted to talk about it. In some cases, I have stayed in touch with a couple of those people who had written to me at that time, particularly women who were girls at the time that they wrote to me. I guess I had the sense that if you could make a difference, you know, if by fostering that kind of relationship, and sometimes you can make a difference, sometimes you really can't. My priorities have changed a lot. I feel that now is the time to get deeper as opposed to wider. I feel that 10 years ago I served a good function in the world. I felt like that song Luca had a meaning to people and that people needed to hear it for whatever reason. And I was glad to have been there at that moment.
10 years on from Luca, and Vega's priorities have drastically changed. Marriage to her producer, Mitchell Froom, and the birth of a daughter, Ruby, mean that her desire is to stay in New York, where she has returned to her acoustic roots.
So I know that you're standing there asking yourselves, who is Billy Pearl, the international fun boy? Billy Pearl was a band leader in the 30s. No, and my grandmother was his drummer in his band. He had an all-girls band.
Bringing up Ruby has been a challenge, and Vega has come to realize the importance of passing on a sense of the spiritual to the next generation.
Ruby's father is Jewish, and so his family celebrates a lot of the holidays. She likes the sense of community. You know, she likes being with everyone at the table, and she likes the different rituals that happen. Right now, I don't know that I'll raise her in any particular faith. But I think it's really good for children to have some idea of some religion, because you need a vocabulary to express those things that happen spiritually, because otherwise, if you don't have a vocabulary for it, you don't trust that they're real.
If your love were taken from me, every color would be black and white. It would be as flat as the world before Columbus. That's the day that I lose half my sight.
The World Before Columbus is a song that is written to my daughter. I had at the back of my mind the sense that I didn't know my own father and that he didn't know his own parents.
All the trees would freeze in this cold ground.
You know, that if I were to lose her for some reason, that it would be devastating to me, and that it would be, we would be caught up in a pattern again. And that was very disturbing to me.
If your love were taken from me, every light that's bright would soon go dim. It would be as dark as the world before Columbus. Down the waterfall and I'd swim over the bridge.
I guess you get to a point in your life where you decide you've had enough. And that's when you become mature. When you're not just kind of trying to get more and more, and you don't have that same out of control hunger that you had. And you decide, well, this is really enough. And that's where I feel like I'm at. That's where I feel like I'm, what I'm doing right now. Just said, okay, these are my limits. And this is as far, this is as much as I want right now.
Those men who lust for land and for riches strange, and who love those trinkets of desire, oh, they never will have you, 'cause they'll never know the gold or the copper in your hair. How could they weigh the worth of you so rare?